part. I am Techeetah Lopez, your queen of salsa soul in Hollywood and the pot. Don't even think about singing this time, Art.
Okay.
He likes to get in, he likes to be the star. But anyway, there's only one star, there's more. Anyway, we are going again. We are, just to let you know, we are now officially on Roku, on Sparks TV. So the season one, and will be, we're probably gonna do about maybe 12, 15 episodes of season one. So today our guest will be Lou Pizarro from Operation Repo. There are so many things that I didn't even know that he got his hands into. And you know, you can have a friend, you know the scenario when you have a mother, your brother, your sister, you know, your sister-in-law, and they have like projects on the side. But you guys, when you get together, all you do is talk about each other, you know, and you're just hanging out and having a good time, but nobody ever asks. We never talk about work, right? So I didn't even know that Lou Pizarro was on Telemundo. So he walks in today, and as you'll see, and my housekeeper was starstruck. She was like, oh my goodness, I need to take a peach. She didn't say it like that, but he was like, almost like that.
Pretty accurate.
Yeah, pretty accurate, right? So, what I wanted to get today off of my soul and my soul's soul segment. There's so many people right now that are without income. Our lives are changing. Matter of fact, my husband must be thinking about me. Art and I were watching a program the other day, which was called Social Distancing. And again, Art is in the background. Come and say hi, Art, real quick. Again, for those that don't, this is Art, my camera guy. He's the camera guy, he's the gopher, he's the producer, he's the everything, right? So this is Art Aguilar.
And I got a good hip now, so I can actually go
Oh yeah. That's one of the reasons it took so long for us to get another episode, because he was healing, right?
Yeah.
Aww.
Time to go back? Wait a minute, I'm waiting for this.
Yeah, exactly. So we were watching a program on social distancing. I thought, what the hell? What kind of program are we gonna, you know, what kind of movie is this? I thought actually it was gonna be pretty boring, right? And then all of a sudden I started breaking out of tears because it was our new norm. You know, we're talking about people in one segment, there was this one woman that was working, taking care of an elderly lady. And then she had on her phone, she had two cameras watching her child doing homework, and the baby had to be about 7-8 years old. Art, was that?
Yeah.
7-8 years old. But she had to work in order to put food on the table. She had to work. And that's what's happening right now, everybody. You know, we have people that that are fortunate, that have daytime jobs, and they have their kids at the house.
And no child care.
And no child care at all, right? So in this social distancing, I think it was like 8 episodes. On the second episode, it showed a caretaker taking care of the woman and then her having to take care of her child on the phone. And if you want to see something very interesting, see that. Also, there was another episode where a loved one had actually passed away, right? And how they had to do everything on Zoom. Anyway, it's a really good watch, but it's our reality. Everybody's over the phone. Oh, there was an alcoholic guy also. It's a really good program. So that's definitely a must watch, and that's on Netflix. Or was it on Amazon?
It was on Netflix.
Yeah, no, it was on Netflix, yeah. So that's a good one to watch. But what I'm trying to get out, people, is that just our new normal. Is it a new normal? Is it just gonna be the way of living, right? Again, what I'm doing right now, pre-recording stuff, right? Not going out there. And even though me and Art are going to, later on the segment, you will see us out in the town. I think we're going to go get some ice cream today, or I don't know what we're going to get. Whoever knows. But right now, what was on my soul, the soul today, was income. There are some people that cannot work, are lost their jobs, and are getting laid off, right? Well, what do? Well, there's a lot that you can do. You know, there's people right now that are making arts and crafts, literally will make a pair of earrings, out of plastic and paint it and put little thingies and a $5 investment, right? And turn around and sell a pair of earrings for $8, right? Find a craft of yours. It doesn't matter what craft. It could be woodwork, it could be earrings, it could be necklaces, it could be clothes, it could be blankets. Think of something that you can do that you can sell. Because, ladies and gentlemen, if you have a phone and you're watching me right now, you have a hub to sell something, okay? Anyway, if you have a bank, right? You have to have a bank. If you're watching me, you should have a bank, right? Find something, think out of the box. We are living in a new world right now. There's big ways of making money. If you don't know of any ideas, contact me. I'll give you a couple of ways to make money. There's candles you can make. And if you're not a crafty person, I don't know, poetry, anything. Matter of fact, Art, you were talking to me about something the other day.
Well, one of, he's an entertainer, he's a guitarist. Uh-huh. He was looking for other ways to make money, just like you were saying earlier. Uh-huh. And what he does, he goes on Craigslist or whatever to look for free furniture people are giving away. And what he does, he gets it, picks it up. I mean, he goes every day and he picks it up and he refurbishes it, puts new knobs on it, paints them. And his garage looks like a darn warehouse, like a furniture warehouse, because he's picking up free
stuff.
Headboards.
Yeah. How many times have you guys seen free in Craigslist? Come and pick it up. Go get your truck. Pick it up. Come on. If you don't know how to refurbish, come on. Who doesn't know how to paint? Okay, get a paint. Ask your friends and family, do you have extra cans of paint that you don't want? Color it, varnish it, put it out there, and put it up again. If you get something for free, if you even just get $10 from that, that's $10 you didn't have, or $20. Ask all your family members, whoever. Does anybody have any leftover paint? Somebody always has leftover paint or acrylics or anything like that. How hard is it to draw a flower? Just something. There's always something. Anything else you're thinking, Art?
You know, off the top of my head, no. I mean, I've been looking at my baseball card collection, you know, and I've been like getting rid of those. You know, there's cards there, you don't know what they're worth. Sometimes, you know, whatever, you can get $15, $10.
Yeah.
And a lot of times I've given them to my grandkids and let them make some extra money. Mm-hmm. I'm glad I've got rid of at least 80% of them. I still have 20%.
Okay.
The cutest thing was, one of my grandkids asked me, "Hey, Art, do you have any?" Oh no, he said, "Hey, Grandpa."
Grandpa.
Yeah, he said,
"I was gonna say what?"
I know. He said, "Hey, Grandpa, do you have any Kobe Bryant cards?"
Ah!
And I said, "Yeah." I said, "You won't get those until I'm gone."
Oh, he's like, "See how dumb Grandpa is."
That's right.
Again, ideas, all kinds of ideas.
Old.
Anything back, way, way, way back before Christ, we used to have all kinds of, well, not even after that, bartering, all kinds of stuff that you could be doing, right? So think of ways to make money. There's Uber, there's Instacart. People are doing all kinds of stuff on the corner, right? Selling vegetables, no. What are you looking at me like that for?
Just that corner statement.
See where his mind's at? It's in the gutter. Okay, whatever. Make some type of income. Just don't sit there and let that ship sink, right? There's always something out there. But on a happy note, we have Lou Pizarro today, and he's going to be talking about his ins and outs of Operation Repo and his new shows and his new movie and all that good stuff, okay? But anyway, if you have any questions and you don't know, well, Techeetah, what can I do? Drop me a line, a message, and we'll be right back with Lou Pizarro.
Whiskey sour, bubbling up, the game is on. Liquor hour, whiskey sour, bubbling up, the game is on. Join Techeetah Lopez and Hollywood in the Park's entire audience by advertising your brand, product, or personality with your commercial here. Email techeetah@gmail.com for more info.
If you're cool, I'm cool.
I had my test.
Oh, I got tested in this. Then my husband got tested, right? And I'm like, at first he got tested and he goes, aren't you gonna get tested? I'm like, well, if you ain't got it, then I ain't got it, right?
Yeah, your cooties are my cooties.
Exactly. We intertwine cooties, right? So we're gonna go. Hi, everybody, and welcome to my 10th episode of Hollywood in the Park. Now, of course, we have our wonderful guest, Lou Pizarro. Thank you, Lou.
Thanks for having me.
I appreciate you coming out here because the world is going to crap. I don't even know what the hell, before you know, but wait a minute. I bought this house, in December, and I'm like, wait a minute. December's coming upon us again, right?
Time flies.
But I didn't put up a couple of episodes because I just wanted to get everybody used to what is the norm, What is the freaking norm, Wearing the mask and stuff like that. So I figure, those that are scared out of their wits like I am and are staying home and stuff, I'll invite you guys over. So I knew you were protected.
Yeah, and it's important to, in my opinion, to social distance, try not to get into crazy places that nobody's wearing a mask, just be respectful, and this will be over before you know it. And people are calling it the new norm. Whatever, you call it whatever you want to call it. Look, we'll get past this. We've been through worst.
Oh yeah, what?
Oh, there's been pandemics through time that have just, disintegrated the population. So this is something
like the apes.
I mean, there are all kinds of crazy stuff. Well, I mean, you get a little way back.
Noah's Ark.
Well,
he said,
Which, by the way, if you guys ever get a chance to watch that movie Noah with Russell Crowe, fabulous movie.
Oh, really?
It's about Noah's Ark, yeah.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, but you're right, though. We had the pandemic in, the 20s, and then we had another one in the 50s or something? I don't know.
Even before that, in the 1800s.
1800s, yeah.
Yeah, we had some insane stuff, but... Again, it's like I've had some friends that unfortunately passed, and may they rest in peace.
Yeah.
And due to the COVID, and some of them did have underlying conditions, and some didn't.
Yeah.
You just don't know how it's going to affect. So just be respectful. Don't be a knucklehead, like I say. Just be respectful because you don't want to be blamed or someone to point the finger that someone passed because of your ignorance. And so that's just how I feel about it, So hey, thanks for having me on the show.
I'm so glad you came over. There was a few times that I was going to pick up the phone and I was going to call. I'm like, oh my gosh, should I call? Well, how about if he doesn't want to come over? I know he's protecting himself and I know I'm protecting myself because, we got shit to do, we got things to do.
Oh, yeah.
So we can't get out there unless we're in a protection mode, right? And I go, just pick up the phone. If he says no, then I gotta What's that?
This is my sanitizer, CaliforniaBlending.com. It's one of my sponsors for our radio show, Repo Radio. And here, just take a smell of it. Just take a little whiff. Oh, and it's not bad. And
it
doesn't leave all this gooey stuff on you. And I use it a lot. And people kind of make fun of me. They're like, dude, use it as like perfume and cologne. I'm like, yeah.
Well, that's a good thing. So, everyone knows you as Operation Repo and all that kind of stuff. So let's start there. When did the show, for those that don't know who he is Lou Pizarro of Operation Repo. The program was in on Telemundo. You did it, I didn't even know you did it in English. I didn't know you did it in Spanish.
Yeah, most people that don't realize that. So we did Operation Repo in Spanish for Telemundo.
Okay.
And we also did it for True TV. And I'll get to that. I know you want to hear the whole story. We did it for two different networks. And then to this day, it's literally just airing everywhere all over the world on different networks, Spanish, English. It's been relanguaged. So it's, in Italian and different.
Really?
To different dialects.
Oh, wow.
Different languages. So we've been blessed with that. It's interesting.
I didn't even know that. So Italy, Spanish, just everywhere, any place that any Latin countries. You know, there's more Latin countries than anything.
Oh yeah, there's
everywhere. A lot. You know, Cuba, Venezuela, Uruguay, Paraguay, Brazil, yeah. What's it? Puerto Rico, which is actually part of the United States, and because it just goes on and on. So I'm pretty sure you guys are like freaking everywhere.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. You know, no complaints there.
So when did it start?
So to tell the story, I got to kind of digress. Okay. I'm not going to go too far back. I'm just going to go to 2004.
Okay.
2004. I am literally in the repo world. I'm a repossessor by
trade. So you were a repossessor. So it's not something that all of a sudden somebody say, hey, you're a great actor. Let's have you be a repo guy. It's not that.
No.
It's real stuff, right?
Right.
Okay.
So I'm a repossessor. You know, I was in the Marine Corps, and then I'm working for Continental Airlines. So people don't realize that I work for Continental, and I retired there, took the early retirement plan, and just only in 2005.
Oh.
I was there for like half my life, right? Mm. And I was doing repos at the same time.
Okay.
And so I get a call.
To repo plane.
Yeah, no, I've done that.
Yeah, you have.
Okay. We don't want to talk about pre-repo. I don't know if the statute of limitations have passed. So
you get a call.
So I get a call from Maria Garcia from Telemundo, the news department.
Mm.
And she says, hey, we're looking to do a story on the day in the life of a repo man.
Oh.
I'm like, okay, I'm interested. I go, but my Spanish is not the best. She goes, oh, don't worry. We'll help you out with that.
Okay.
So she showed up with the producer, Diego Caro. So they were both responsible.
Now, how does she know you? You know this.
That was the question I asked.
Okay.
I asked that question.
I want to know that.
And
this world is who you know.
Yeah.
You know,
and I spoke with Maria Garcia just recently, okay? And I asked that question. I never asked you. Why did you call me? She goes, because you were the first repo company in the phone book.
What?
Yes.
How about you were terrible actors or something? You know what I'm saying?
Well, you know, literally the first company, my company at the time was called Access Adjusters.
Okay.
So hello, A, right?
Oh,
you know. And it's so ironic because as a kid, man, I used to go around going, hey, I thought it was a Bonds, right?
Okay, oh well.
So, yeah, maybe that's not funny. We need to get Gilbert Escobar in here to do the jokes.
I know, yeah.
So I get this call. They show up to my shop. We jump in my tow truck. It's about 10:30 at night. Mm-hmm. They have a camera guy. And we shoot down to South Central.
10:30 at night?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, because you repossess during the night.
Oh, that's right.
So it takes an hour to get over there or less. Mm-hmm. We get out there and, you know, we repossess a couple of cars and she's like, wow, you're not scared? I'm like, no, I'm scared.
What? So it was real shit though?
Oh yeah, no, it was real.
Okay.
This was before the show.
Okay, before the show.
Yeah, so this is real. So the next day she showed up again, she brought someone else. She goes, you got to see this guy work. So at that time too, I had another repossessor. His name was Jossie, one of my best repossessors of all time. I took him out with me and we did the same thing, you know, so. That was it. It was over. About a week later, literally, I'm at a store called Mercado del Valle, which is like a Vallarta, right?
Okay.
And it's right there in Pacoima, right on Glen Oaks and Paxton. Mm-hmm. It's a church now, by the way. So I'm in there and they go, hey, el Repo de Telemundo. I'm like, what?
I
didn't even know it aired.
Oh, okay.
And everyone's like, wow, pulling out their Polaroids. Can we take a picture? They're like literally at Mercado del Valle.
Oh, wait, ponete el pinche carro.
Buying cameras. They were buying cameras to take pictures with me. I was
wow.
Because they seen this news segment, you know, on Telemundo.
Oh, okay.
So it was insane. So she says, hey, we got to do another segment. People loved it. I'm like, all right, cool. So we did something else, how to steal a car in under 30 seconds.
No.
I go, I'm going to do really good there. Been there, done that.
Give people in the barrio some ideas, okay?
So now it's, that's interesting. So now I had the Idol detectives and the news department there. And we were at, Mid Valley Tow in Van Nuys. Mm-hmm. And we were using their yard. And so they had two cars for me. So the idea is, how long would it take me to get this car, start it up, and leave with it? And then the second one, how long would it take me to steal a car with an alarm in a club?
Oh, shoot.
So, now when I did that, I think it was, I don't know, maybe, I want to say 15 seconds to steal, to get the car, get in it, and drive away. Mm. The second one was under 30 seconds. Oh. And they couldn't believe it. So, the detectives, the other detectives there, they said, hey, man, we need to have a meeting with you.
You fit the description of some guys that stole some cars.
I couldn't lie about that. But their conversation was, look, we can't have you show how you're doing that. And they talked to tell, so they had to edit around that.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay. And that's it. They didn't ask me anything else, but hey, we can't have you show that on there, you know? Mm-hmm. So that segment came out and it was a hit. Then other people that year from Telemundo called me to do other segments. So I was their go-to guy.
Okay.
And so the idea was, the next segment was the top 10 cars that get stolen.
Oh.
And then I did, and it was a national segment. And then I did another segment, why do cars get stolen during the summer? Yeah. And then finally I did identity theft by breaking in the cars. We did that at the San Fernando Swap Meet.
Okay.
So now it's like I'm their go-to guy, right? And this is great. And so I was always filming the repos for purposes of insurance and safety, because a lot of people lie, you know, and.
Really?
Are you kidding me? Mm.
People don't. They really lie?
But you're funny. She's a comedian. So.
Well, I don't know if you're aware, but I'm licensed with the Bureau Investigative Service, State of California, for financial fraud.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, then no.
I worked with repossessors for Glendale Federal Bank.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I worked in their department for that. So I was the collector. When I found your vehicle, I would tell you where to go. And this was back in the late 80s, early 90s. So I know a lot about your from the bank end.
Wow. So you know what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. So. Now at this point, what the hell was I? What was I talking about? Art, what was I saying? You remember?
she got us both.
Let's put the camera guy.
I shocked him.
She got us both.
You said they lie about their insurance, who they are, blah blah blah.
So that's why you videotape.
So I'm about to finally answer the question you've been asking: is how did this show come about?
Okay.
So I'm filming this stuff. I had a Sony 4.0 megapixel, just a little camera that had video, and I would record, you know, the repossessions just for insurance and safety, and the cops would show up. I'd show them, hey, I didn't hit that person. I didn't pull out a gun. You know how many times they said I pulled a gun?
Oh, I can imagine. Yeah.
You know, so.
Role reversal.
Yeah.
Role reversal.
So now that's what's going on. And then I go through a divorce. Huh? I go through a divorce and I'm like, okay, so I want to finish this pilot. Called a couple of friends of mine that went to the same church that I was going to. They were in film school, I was. And we got together, I edited this piece with them, and it sat there for a year.
Oh.
A whole year. So I disappeared, didn't do anything. I mean, I was gone. I was staying in a condo. My brother, he was doing everything, bless him. He was, you know, kind of doing everything for me because I just didn't want to do anything. I was in a weird state of mind, right?
Depressed, life changing.
You can call it depressed.
Yeah. I've married four times. I know what depression is.
So, and then one day I just woke up. I guess I said, what are you doing, man? You know, it's like, what's going on? So I called up Maria Garcia and she says, oh my God, Lou, we thought you were dead. We've been trying to get a hold of you.
Oh.
She goes, yeah, we've been trying to get a hold of you. And I'm like, ah, it's a long story, but I have something I want to show you. She goes, all right, come down to the station. So I went to NBC when they were in Burbank. Well, they're still on. Delano was there. And I showed them that DVD. Mm-hmm. And they were like, wow, they've never seen anything like this. But we have never seen any reality show like this. And then all of a sudden, everybody in that newsroom was watching this. Mm-hmm. And they go, you need to meet Fatima. She's the program director.
I knew that.
Yeah, I'm sure you do. Yeah,
she's awesome. Matter of fact, I met her at the Latin Grammys, I believe.
Yes.
Yes, that's her and her husband.
Yeah, that's her.
Matter of fact, my publicist introduced me to her.
So she seen this and she like said, wow, this is amazing. She goes, I'm going to take a chance on you, Lou. She goes, I'm going to take a chance on you. And because of just the chain of events, Maria Garcia, Diego Cairo, Fatima Concables, they took a chance on me and it just blew up. Wow. That's how we got on TV on Telemundo. And because it was such a you know, Thursday night or whatever night it was at 8 o'clock, the ratings were beating Univision. Mm-hmm. So, and I didn't even realize that because I was just, you know, doing this show. I was just telling, you know, they had their production company that they hired for us. And I get a call one day from Nate DeMayo from NPR News. And he goes, "Hey Lou, I want to do a news segment on you, on your success on the show and the high ratings and you're beating Univision." I go, "What?" I had no clue about that. So when are they going to let me know that? I mean, I didn't really care, but at the time I was just happy. That,
yeah.
So you can look at that Repo Man hijacks ratings on NPR News and you can listen to that whole segment. It's interesting. Then True TV came to us and they said, "Look, we want to do this show in English. Can you do it? You have a pilot?" I'm like, "Yeah, bam, I already had it." Uh-huh. So, and it might sound real easy and all, you know, but it was a lot more bumps in the road. It was really
hard. I can imagine.
But it happened. Now we're, you know, English nothing, mainstream.
Nothing ever showing or worth waiting for, like they say, comes easy.
Yeah, no. You know, so it was actually Court TV. Court TV wanted us to be the transitional show from Court TV to True TV. I don't know if you remember that. So we were that show, and that's how we made history with them, and that's how we got all the respect and love. And if you've seen at that time, for many years, 6 or 7 years, True TV was basically, every show was in the format that I created. So I consulted, I did other pilots for them. I did Gypsy Hunter pilot, I told you, we should have you on the show. Miss Gitana right here, look at her.
Well, you know what, my family actually, my father's side, my grandma is Lupe Quijas. That was her maiden name. Mm. So I come from a line of Quijas with blonde hair, blue eye, obviously I got the dark hair. But there is a town in Spain called Quijas, Spain, mm-hmm. right? And we do have gypsy blood in it. Obviously I absorbed all the gypsy blood.
I can see.
Yeah. Every time Christmas comes around, my aunts and my tías and my mother, they always buy me the big earrings and the rings and, wow. you know, and stuff like that and the off the shoulder stuff, you know. And I love it. I've always loved it ever since. As a matter of fact, that's why this program is called Hollywood in the Park. Yeah. Because when I used to show up to any event or anything, they're like, "I do all Hollywood in the Park." And it was always like, "I do. Oh, look at you, girl, all Hollywood in the Park." And I was always dressed up. But my thing is, you know, just put some earrings on and, you know, whatever. And just, but I've always looked like a gypsy. You like it?
Yeah, it's great, man. It's like, I have a lot of gypsy friends. Rusty Marks, his family, I spoke to him yesterday. And he introduced me to the gypsy world when we were doing this pilot. And it was a phenomenal pilot. You can actually go to YouTube and look up Gypsy Hunter. You can find some clips of trailers and teasers and see what I'm talking about. But let me tell you, when he introduced me to the gypsy world, and they don't accept just anybody.
You think they accept me?
Oh, absolutely. You got the blood. But me, because I don't have that Romani or whatever you know you have to be. I went to a gypsy wedding, and they never let anybody go to one of their weddings that's not in the family or anything like that. And I started meeting all these beautiful women, these beautiful men. These guys were just. Like class
beautiful.
Acts.
Exactly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I was like, wow.
We know how to dress.
And I started finding out a lot of their culture. And man, I was shocked. I'm not gonna even talk about some of the things that go on because I might get in trouble.
Yep.
And out of respect for them because but wow, what an interesting
Oh yeah, there's a lot
lifestyle, yeah. And it's
so I have some stuff cooking in the backyard too, by the way.
Oh nice. So I noticed you have, you know, skulls like Dia de los Muertos. Is that what that's about?
Since we're in October,
yeah.
This is actually a Halloween thing.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, but don't you love them though?
But you have it everywhere in your house. You have the candles, the skulls.
Exactly, the candles, the skulls. I've always loved sugar skulls. Just not like plain ugly. They have to have like the flowers and yeah. They have to be decorated. And my son, he turned out a lot like that too, you know? Okay. So.
Well, I mean, we all like sugar. I like sugar mamas, but. That's a different story. Ay, ay, ay. So yeah, so that's the kind of the Operation Repo in short. I know it was like 20 minutes long, but there are just so many different things involved and so many, you know, trials and tribulations and ups and downs and roller coaster rides. But at the end of the day, man, you know, we're still here.
Oh yeah, that's definitely. So anyway, with that thought, right, we'll go ahead and be right back after this commercial break and we'll get into all the people in the cast.
Okay.
How about that, right?
You got it.
We'll be right back.
Who are you? Who are you, first of all?
This is my brother.
This is your brother?
This is my brother, Craig. This is okay. Our car. I mean, we...
Okay,
this is how we get around.
So he was, this is how, he was in the Army?
Yeah,
he lost his leg, man. I mean,
because you guys are me, he said he served in Iraq, in Yemen.
You know, I just can't believe that their brother just told me that he was in the Army. And the guy's telling me he was in the Marines. And he's telling me he served in Iraq, you know, in Yemen. I'm thinking, wait a minute, man.
Look, something's up.
You're just trying to do your job.
Do me a favor.
So am I. You know what? I've been doing my job. I did my job.
You need to just like back off because somebody's lying here. Somebody's lying here.
Shoot my leg off.
You know what? How about you have a little bit of respect and don't call me a bitch. You want a bitch, you're going to be a bitch. You need to back away from me.
No,
you need to back away from me. Don't call me a bitch.
No right to
touch your hands on me. Get off me.
Put your hand on my daughter. What's wrong with you?
Linda's arguing with this guy. Then he puts his hands on Linda, and that was it. So I pushed this category. What's wrong with you? You know, and I pushed him. You know, I'm like, wow, what more can happen?
What's wrong with you? Get out of our car. Get out of here.
Listen, relax.
No, come on.
Relax.
Get out of our car.
Relax.
No,
relax.
I will take it. No.
Relax.
No.
Get, dude, relax.
Get out of here. Get out of here.
What the hell?
Join Techeetah Lopez and Hollywood in the Park's entire audience by advertising your brand, product, or personality with your commercial here. Email techeetah@gmail.com for more info.
She's been cooking all day, smells so good and saucy. Red love, let me get a taste in the morning with some eggs. Yeah.
Give me the
Okay, we're back. All right, we're back. So where did we leave off? So I was going to ask you, your children. I see that you have a sister on the program, you have your daughter on the program, and you have a guy named Freud on the program, and then Matt. So who are these people other than I know that your sister and your daughter, so are the other ones related to you?
So the way it works, because Sonia, that my sister,
yes,
she was married to Freud, so he was my brother-in-law.
Oh my gosh, yeah. Really?
Yeah, so and then they have my nephew together, little Freud, which is like 6'4", man, 300 pounds. He's like 25, 26 now. And then at the time when we first started the show, we had Vanessa. And then Vanessa, she ended up getting married and starting a family, so I had to replace her. And my daughter had just turned 18.
Oh, okay.
So Linda is my daughter, so that's how she, you know, came to the show. And Matt was an employee. So they were all technically my employees.
Oh, okay.
Before the show. Uh-huh. And that's pretty much, you know, how they came to be. And then, you know, some people, they came in and out of the series.
Okay, all right. Also, you know how rumors fly and things like that,
Great
right?
song.
Yeah. Look at all these rumors. Yeah. So it's not a rumor, but there was a tragic situation that happened in 2018. Carlos.
Yes.
Carlos Lopez.
Yes. So Carlos Lopez, rest in peace. He was new talent on the show. So Carlos and Ronnie, they were like 18. They were like the next Matt and Freud in a sense. Matt and Freud was together. The big guy and the little guy. Mm-hmm. And the same thing with Ronnie, the big guy and the little guy, you know. So kind of like an Abbott and Costello. They made good teams. So Carlos, he was an Army veteran. Yeah. And he was the guy that, Carlos would tell me, he was the guy that would go out there and retrieve, you know, all the soldiers that were, you know, killed and their vehicles from IEDs, you know, from road bombs and whatever the case, and this is what he had to deal with. And so it was, when he came to the show, I was really excited because yes. he had, you know, all that energy and stuff. And at the same time when we talked, I was like, man, this guy, you know, I ain't complaining. My life was easy. This guy was out there doing, you know, some wild stuff. So that's what he was doing out there. And he was great for the show. He was an actor, you know, was acting and there you go.
But what happened?
So, you know, it was PTSD, you know, got to him, and he ended up, you know, killing himself. Yeah. Yeah, it was a sad situation, and again, it's a...
So all that bullshit, I don't just say bullshit, but they have to go through, because, you know, my husband's over there.
Yeah.
He's been over there. My husband's been working for the military for over 30 years, and he's been in Iraq for 11.
Wow.
And even though he comes back looking sane, I know he ain't sane.
Sure.
Right? Because he's just like...
That's why he keeps on going back.
Kill mode, exactly. Because he hasn't got, sorry, sweetie, you're probably listening to this. But you know, there's nothing wrong. But you know, you don't ever know what's going on in somebody. And my mom always says that, you never know what's going on in somebody's life. Don't ever say anything wrong, don't ever put them down, because you never know. And when I read that, you know, I said, oh, wow. So that's why I wanted to make sure there wasn't a touchy subject.
And, you know, it's funny, that same conversation I had teaching earlier with your camera guy, your producer, Art. Mm-hmm. So, you know,
be careful. You mean that one right there?
Yeah,
like,
right
there?
That guy right there.
So, he's just like, look at. He's like, what's the say?
So, let me say to your husband, man, thanks for your service. Love you, all my troops out there. And like, now, like, since we're in that subject, my son, you know, he's 20 years old now. He's over 2 years now in the Army.
Mm.
He's at Fort Bragg, North Carolina. He's
at
82nd Airborne.
Oh, wow.
He's a Black Hawk crew chief.
Oh, wow.
And he's with the Mustangs. So, love you guys. Good job, son. And he just got his orders. And he's going to do 9 months in Afghanistan.
Oh.
So, so that's kind of, you know, like, oh, man, here we go, you know.
Yeah.
So, but hey, you know what, I'm proud of him, and this is what he wanted to do. So.
Well, you know, if that's what they want to do, you know, then, you know, so. Anyway, well, again, God rest his soul.
Yeah, rest in peace.
You know, it's like, you know, shit doesn't happen to them, but then they come back, and some of them just can't take it.
Yeah, and I had several buddies from day one that I was in, you know, Travis Gilbertson, you know, he same thing too. I mean, there's other guys out there, but it's a sad situation when you hear it so close to home, man. And all you can do is like, man, why didn't he call me? Why was there something I can do? And it eats you up, you know, because that's how you think. It's like, man, you know, at any rate, yeah, I'm glad you asked that because, we're always thinking about Carlos, man.
So yeah, it's a sad, it's a sad situation, you know. Anyway, let's get on another note before I start crying like a big old baby because I think about that all the time, you know. So how many children do you have?
Oh, that's a great question. I know I have
six kids,
but here's the beautiful news. I have four grandkids, all boys, and my daughter just 2 weeks ago gave birth to twins.
Oh no, yes. Really?
Yeah. So, and we're gonna do this little thing on YouTube, but yeah, so I have four grandkids. I'm really excited about it, and it's really showing my age, but. So yeah, you know, I wanted 10 kids, but that didn't happen, but I got 10, I guess now. I got 6 of my own and 4 grandkids, so there you go. Anybody want to borrow some kids?
I know. Yeah. Okay, so tell us, what do you, oh, matter of fact, you brought before. Chewy.
Yes, yes.
The Chewy doll.
Yeah, so in behalf of La Familia Melgoza, we want to give you this Chewy Bravo bobblehead in memory of the late Chewy Bravo. And what we do is that on our radio show or any events that we do, we give them away for free. And simply that way, you know, to keep his memory going. The guy had a great heart. And for being such a little guy, he had a humongous heart. And just, you know, hashtag recipes Chewy Bravo. You might go somewhere, like Randy was in Arizona, and took Chewy with them and took him on a little tour.
Aww.
And people take him to different places.
I think I'm gonna take Chewy with me everywhere I go to. And a thing also too, it was just something that happened, you know?
Yeah, it was a sad situation. He was in Mexico and he was out there, you know, he goes out there all the time with his family, and he just, he had some type of rupture in his stomach. You know, we're not getting into details because it's not, you know, my thing to say, but I know that he went to a hospital, a small hospital, and they didn't have what he needed to, and so in the ambulance and route to another hospital, he bled so much that he had a heart attack.
Oh,
and
they couldn't revive
him. Yeah. So sad situation. Rest in peace, brother.
That's so we'll definitely be taking Chewy wherever.
Yeah, yeah. So
put him in my purse. And yes. It's just Chewy. Oh, I just got Chewy in there. That's
It's little Chewy Bravo.
So tell me, what do you have? I know you have a lot of stuff coming up. So tell everybody what you have going on in the future. What's going on? What's in the Lou mind? What do you land up?
So, coming from the reality. You know, creating reality shows. I've been blessed that because of the Operation Repo, I created Furtivos de la Ley, Furtivos de la Ley Los Angeles, Cazadores de la Noticia, Dame Tinta, and I did a whole bunch of other pilots, etc. But the cool thing about it, that it's allowed me to help other people that were in my position that wanted to become producers, directors, and TV stars. It allowed me to help these guys. So I was able to help mold and give my 2 cents in. So that's kind of like a feeling of pride that I get. To this day, I get phone calls. Hey, I have this idea. What do you think? Mm-hmm. Who can I pitch it to? I'm like, here, call this guy. Call this guy here. Good luck. That's kind of our job, right? Leadership by example. Mm-hmm. So I decided I want to go into an independent world now.
Okay.
I want a different life. Independent movies. So I started doing movies.
Oh, wonderful. You were saying that. I remember that.
Yes. So, which is great. I've been blessed. I've done a lot of movies, and they're coming out every quarter right now. So I have a movie literally coming out every 3 months for the next 2 years.
And where can the people watch?
So independent Amazon.
Okay.
Yeah, you can go on any SVOD platform, AVOD platform. You can go to Barnes and Nobles. You can go to Target. You can go, you know, to Vudu, which is Walmart. So they're basically everywhere.
Okay.
And so I'm building my resume. I'm doing this because I'm building my resume. And I'm building a tight circle and a tight group, kind of in the way of Clint Eastwood.
Oh, okay.
And then we all look up to have that format of production values, of professional decorum. Mm-hmm. You know, Clint Eastwood, he always comes in under budget. His films always do really well. Mm-hmm. And he takes care of his crew, his family. He takes care of them, even when they're not working. And that's kind of like, like, you know, when I was in the military, a platoon, you know, the kind of the A-team thing, that's what I based everything to this day. If you look at all my TV shows, mm-hmm. they're all based on an A-team.
Mm, okay.
They really are. If you look like Operation Repo, you look at Matt. Matt was my Mr. T, B.A. Baracus.
Mm.
That was him.
How is he doing, by the way?
He's doing good.
Oh, good.
He's doing good, yeah. So I haven't seen him since before the COVID, but we had breakfast and we did a couple things. Let's see, we did the Pacoima Parade last year before COVID. This year it's canceled. And I'm proud to see him. We got the Cholo Zombies coming out the 24th.
The what?
It's a Cholo Zombie movie. It's a
comedy. Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah, so. And then you can also see Matt on Operation Repo, the movie, along with Froy, Sonia, Linda, and that's out on Amazon Prime. So
you can see it there. Have you ever had a part for a gypsy woman?
Yeah, no, I'm telling you. This is what we do. We call on our friends, but it's out of sight, out of mind. So
I'm a great actor.
You have to absolutely keep in touch with me. And this is what I do. So you keep in touch with me, and I'm like, oh, man.
And you know what? I'm glad he said that, because it is true.
Yeah.
Out of sight. It's not that our friends forget about us, right? It's like, oh, man, that's right, Lou, or oh, man, Techeetah, or Art, right? Yeah. It's just our lives get so hectic, you know? And again, if you have a friend out there that, now that we're going through the COVID and things like that, write a list of all the people that you haven't got a hold of, right? I'm not lonely. You know, who am I talking? And then sometimes there's somebody who's so important in our life. It's like, it's almost like a sister. You know they're there, but you're not thinking of them. Because you know they're there, right? And stuff. So, you know, that's what I'm saying, you know.
Sure.
So I'll keep in touch with you.
Yeah, absolutely.
Don't
keep
forget
in touch with
me. Okay?
So that's what I've been doing. So I've been, you know, writing, creating. And now with this whole COVID thing, so I've been getting a lot of calls from networks to pitch them reality shows again. But I was actually trying to get out of that.
Oh, the reality show.
And just when I thought it was out, they pulled me back in. So now I'm working on a bunch of projects. So I'm blessed, I'm grateful.
Oh, that's wonderful.
But I'm still gonna continue the journey with the films, with the movies.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yeah.
And you do your radio show.
I do my radio show.
Uh-huh.
So I've been doing this, October is 10 years that I've been with Dos Costas Communication. 94.3 FM and 102.5 FM, which is owned by the Yola brothers, who actually own LATV, so it's the same organization. And, you know, I've been blessed that the show does really good. You know, it's a morning talk show. I do it once a week, 3 hours, current events and top 40 R&B music, etc. Yeah, so.
You don't play mine?
Yeah, but on the flash side, I'm telling you, I play everybody's music. I just had
you don't play mine. I was joking.
Yeah, you sense me. So I did. That's one of the things that I like doing. Mm-hmm. I like when independent artists call me and say, "Hey, look, you think you can play this? Can you interview me?" I do it all the time.
Okay.
And I'll give, you know, whatever time that their song's on, and it's on the radio, and it's like, what that does for them,
yeah,
it's just like it motivates them.
Exactly.
You know, and it's
a big motivation.
Yeah, absolutely. So there you go.
So, question.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever taken any bribes?
Yeah, you know what?
Please, but do, I will give you this. I'll pretend you're not. You need some money. Have you ever, what is he doing?
There it is. I'll be playing it. You got that. Wow.
That's the one actually Jesse Johnson produced, A Morris Day in the Time.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. I need a mirror. Morris Day? I love that dude. You know what's so funny is that when I see things, they kind of like, they tell me, like this right here, I look at it and I just feel like, does that mean anything? I you know, I'm just... That's check it out, guys. So to answer your question, have I ever taken any bribes? You know what? No. It's and here's
what?
The thing. Yeah, and let me
wasn't
tell you.
Waiting for that.
No, let
that's
me tell
what you
me.
Told me in the kitchen.
Yeah, no. That's so let me tell you about and what she's meaning as anybody said, look, I'm gonna give you a burrito or a taco if you leave my car. All the time. They tell me that all the time, you know, so but it was a job. And don't forget, I was raising a bunch of kids.
Mm.
And the way it works is that I am not gonna put what I've worked so hard to get. Because to start your agency license, mm-hmm. I mean, to start a repo company, you have to get an agency license. And that alone was a fee. Just imagine trying to get a liquor license in LA. It's no different. It's almost impossible.
Yeah, opening a bar or something.
Yeah, it's impossible. Yeah, so it took me 2 years to get that license. And what I did to them in 2 years, man, I will not tell anybody.
Yeah.
So now you get people that are desperate. I get it. You go, look, this is my car. You can't take it. I remember one story that I'll share with you.
And should
I
was the damn bill.
I was in Topanga, the city of Topanga, out in the mountains, right? And I'm like, all right, I normally go there around 6:30 in the morning when the sun's coming up. Mm-hmm. That way I can see what's going on, right? So I get there and I'm looking for an Oldsmobile Bravada. Mm-hmm. It's an SUV and it's all-time four-wheel drive. I see it there, and you can't tow those cars.
Why?
Right? Because they're full-time four-wheel drive, but damage the drivetrain. So you need a flatbed, right? Or them give you the key.
Oh, that's bad.
I hooked up to it, I lifted it up, the dog started barking. I'm in this ranch in the middle of nowhere, man. I could have ended up in this chick's basement for 10 years with a mask on.
Oh, God.
So she comes running down the hill, and she's like a Caucasian girl. She's wearing this white see-through lingerie that's just flapping in the wind, and she's running down. And
she has on purpose.
She has no, yeah, that's what she was wearing. And she's like, what are you doing? I go, to repossession, ma'am. It's a repossession. I'm with the finance company. She's like, no, you can't take my car. And she's like, look, I'll do anything you want.
Ooh, at least she had a fine body.
I'll do anything. She was a good looking woman.
Okay,
you know. And I go, look, I said, I'm doing my job. I go, look, and I'm married. I have kids. I said, no, thank you. And I have a camera roll. I was lying. I go, I have a camera roll in the car. Did it. And then her mom comes running down the hill too.
In another lingerie.
In the lingerie. I'm like,
No, they didn't, really?
No, I'm just kidding.
Okay, I was gonna say, come on.
She comes in her robe and she was just like, this is, ma'am, it's a repossession. I'm with the bank. This is a car, sorry. It's like, you can take off your stuff, give me the keys. And the lady just goes, she flops on the ground. And she flops on the ground, the young girl, and I'm like, lady, that's the worst acting I've ever seen.
Oh no.
And she goes, I'm desperate. She goes, I'm desperate. I need my car. I said, look, just give me the keys, make the payment, you can come back and get it. She gave me the keys, man, and I got out of there.
Here's
one more story to tell you. And here's the big point. Why I don't take bribes and why you shouldn't. So I'm repossessing this car that nobody can get. And the finance company says, give it to Access, they'll get the car. I'm really diligent, so I'm looking for this car. They said it's in the garage. So I looked through the garage window one day, it was in there. And every morning I'm going by this house. One day the garage is open early in the morning and the gate's open. Makes it legal for me to go in there, as you know.
Legal.
So I back my truck in there, I hook up to the car and I'm lifting it up, and the girl comes out. And she looks at me and she starts crying. She goes, you can't take my car. I says, man, you know, they've been calling you. You've been mouthing off. You told them all the stuff on the phone. And it's like, you didn't think they were going to get your car. She's crying, you can't take my car. I says, I have to. She goes, you don't understand. I'm on my way to take my mom to the hospital. She's diabetic. She has gangrene.
Oh, God.
They're going to amputate her leg.
Was it true, though?
So I'm thinking, you hear this all the time. Mm-hmm. And I looked at her. And before I could even respond or even feel, the front door opened and the mom comes out. She's wearing shorts and her leg is green.
Oh no!
As a dollar bill. Yeah, and I'm like, I go, look. I says, okay. I said, look, I'm really sorry. I'm gonna drop the car. And she's crying. And I go, but you gotta promise to make the payment. You gotta promise to make the payment. And so I unhooked the car. I even helped the mom get in the car. And I said, look. So what they did, she called the next day. And she said, your guy came, hooked up to the car, and I made him drop the car. And it was like, so guess what? I lost that $100,000 contract, because that's all I was making out of that company a year.
Oh, no.
Because of that. So but I didn't care. I was not.
She told?
Yeah.
Fucking bitch. Oh, sorry.
And so do you see what I'm saying? Why even get into that world? It's like you do your job, get out. Hey, I'm just representing the bank. But under the circumstances, that's not the first, circumstance like that we've had. Mm-hmm. I've had them, Sonia's had them, Matt's had them, Linda's had them, Freud, but everybody, Carlos, Ronnie, we've all been in that situation where you have to make that like, I can't leave this lady walking. She has three kids. I can't put you. So you make those decisions.
Yeah.
And sometimes, you know, they go against
that. That costs you the bread and butter on
but
your
table.
But
it didn't matter, because what if that lady would have passed away? Because she, you know, septic shock or something like that. I didn't want no part of that. Yeah, I don't care if it was a $500,000 contract, because I'm had them, you know, it just wasn't worth it. But to answer your question, it's like, no, I don't pay bribes.
Good. Well, that's definitely good. Okay, well, we're going to take another little commercial break really quick, and we're going to move you a little closer, because you keep on getting out of the camera. I'm not going to bite you, baby.
I don't know what you're talking about, like bribes and lingerie and this and that.
And what we're going to do is we're going to come back, and we're going to talk about how you feel about Hollywood.
You got it.
Okay. We'll be right
back. In two and two. So I see you're not getting any better.
Nah, man.
I told you that pneumonia. Don't play around with that. You need to go to the hospital. In fact, when we're done here, that's where you're going. All right, so. Here, work.
Yeah, I like nighttime repos because we can really pretty much get the car and scoop off, you know? We got a 2009 Chevy Impala we're looking for. Mm-hmm. Right off of Hazel King.
Yeah, we're on Hazel King right now. All right. Panorama City. Don't play in Panorama City. Okay.
We got there and there was a party going on in front of that house. Okay? Load of people, and the first thing I say is, oh my goodness, what are we gonna do?
Get up.
Hey, this car's
me. Hey,
I wanna
talk. Relax, man, relax.
This car's going. Talk to Jose and tell me if this is a car, okay? And he'll get his car back. We're repoing this car.
It got pretty intense. But one of the things that led me to keep on doing my job was the fact that my sister had it under control, and there was another guy there that was trying to control his sister or his friend. So when I seen that, I knew that the guy, you know, he was actually trying to help calm the situation.
Who do you think you are?
I'm not nobody. I'm not
Puerto Rican. You're a Puerto Rican. We're proud.
Idiots.
We're Mexicans here.
Good. My brother's busy doing his things, and all of a sudden, this chick's coming in my face. I got this other bra coming in my face. And guess what? The owner's not here. He's not at home. Oh, no, that's my brother, and he's not home. And I'm trying to say, hey, you know what? Well, we got an order for repossession on this car. We're taking this car. Oh, no, now I got everybody in the neighborhood, obviously, trying to tell me what to do.
You get it? Okay.
Let's go. Hurry up. We got it. Okay. Let's go.
It's
not even your car, and you guys are arguing over the damn car.
Let's go. We're all family here. We're all family. We're protect each other.
Get in. Let's go.
What the?
You're
bad because
you're
repo.
Hey. The
guy did what?
He's in the backseat of that car.
You're kidding me. I can't see.
Are you ready? 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 Are you ready?
Join Techeetah Lopez and Hollywood in the Park's entire audience by advertising your brand, product, or personality with your commercial here. Email techeetah@gmail.com for more info.
Hello, hello, and welcome, welcome, everybody. I'm Skip, your Funkologist, host of the funkiest show on radio. For days and times for your listening pleasure, visit our website, www.afunkabovetherest.com. We are very funky. Do you need proof? Check this out.
What's your take on Hollywood? How do you feel? I know how I feel.
It's, you know, I gotta say, it as a kid, it's always been a dream.
Yeah.
I remember my mom literally taking us downtown as kids on the bus on the RTD 134, if you can remember that, RTD. And we'd go watch three movies, Shaolin movie, karate movies, for like $4.
Oh.
And it was like, I was just mesmerized and amazed. And then my aunt and my mom, they would take us as kids to like the Azteca and watch these Spanish movies.
Yeah, I remember those.
You know, and that was, yeah, it was pretty interesting. So I always liked that, you know. And I wanted to do that. I wanted to get into Hollywood early in my career, and it just didn't work out. I ended up going a different route. Mm. But one thing that I have learned is that if you want to be an actor, an actress, a producer, director, whatever the case may be, you gotta have a career. You gotta have a job underneath your belt. Don't think that you're gonna make it big.
Exactly.
And it's gonna be a lot easier, because as an actor, what happens is that you're worrying about how you're gonna pay rent, who's gonna pay your car payment, and then it gets repoed, sorry.
Yeah, no.
And you start doing things that you would not normally do because you want to be in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
So get a career, go to school, do both. And this is what I preach to my kids.
Yeah.
And I've been blessed that they follow my instructions. And you know, there's nothing wrong with Hollywood if you put it in the right context. Mm-hmm. It can't be your priority. It cannot be your priority.
No, it can't. And I'm so glad you brought that up, and I brought that up somewhere else. Yeah,
we
had a fly in the studio.
A Russian spy fly. That's
exactly.
The same one that was on.
I was going to say, hey, what the hell, dude? Huh. I'm glad you said that, because there's so many people that they think that they, again, if they do this, they do that, they create that, they create this. Oh, I'm going to be rich, I'm going to face. They spent all their money, quit their jobs, right? And because they're going to become rich and famous and blah, 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 and then all of a sudden they want to know why they all broke. You quit your job, you know? You didn't have a backup plan. You're still doing this, and you didn't invest any money. So So I'm glad you said that, because you have to have a day job. And some of the people that have been very successful in this industry have a day job. And a lot of people don't understand. Not only I sell my products online, but I'm a loan officer also. I work with the banking industry still. You know, so I help people with that and credit. Don't look at it.
Oh yeah, Art got stuff. Ice water.
So I'm so glad you said that. But keep on. Sorry.
And you know what? I like to quote Whoopi Goldberg when she said, "You have to create your own opportunities," and that's what you have to do. I mean, it's just not like showing up and you're going to be famous again. You got to have that formula that works for you, and it starts with having a career, a job. You know, it really does. And then, you know, why don't you invest some money in yourself? Get a couple cameras and do some stuff and put your stuff on YouTube. It's a whole different world now than it was when I started.
Exactly.
The opportunity now is huge, because now everyone can compete because of technology. It's a blessing. Yeah. But at the same time, Hollywood will eat you up, man. Mm-hmm. Have a regular job, have a career, and then do Hollywood on the side, and you'll see the difference.
Yeah. Exactly,
oh, yeah.
And it's brutal.
Yeah.
Hollywood can be brutal.
Sure.
Now, brutally honest. There you go.
Yeah.
Hollywood is brutally honest. Or, you understand this, brutally fake.
Yeah.
They will look at you and say, "Oh, you did a wonderful job. You know what? We'll give you a call here. You got my number also." And then all of a sudden, you're waiting for their call. That never happens. You call them, you know, or again, out of sight, out of mind, you know, they do it. So,
absolutely, brutally honest. I did one audition that I can remember in my life, and I never wanted to do an audition because I didn't want to act.
Mm-hmm.
I'm, you know, creator, director, producer. And a friend of mine says, "Hey, I want you to go through this audition, man. This part will be perfect for you." I'm like, "That's not what I'm trying to do." He goes, "Just humor me." So I went over there, and I'm glad I went, because I got to see the BS. You know, the look, they do this because they have to do it. They already have somebody in mind.
Yeah, they do.
And it's the business, but you need to understand the business, because they can crush somebody's soul. Not mine, I got my own thing going on in a sense.
Yeah, you have to.
You know, people jumping off the buildings. Because, you know, and it's
they're not good enough, or they don't feel, or they didn't get the part.
Yeah.
Right. They more than likely, they already had somebody's brother that already got the part. But they have to have the audition.
And I gotta say, I get casted a lot. I help produce, and I do, again, I create my own opportunities. And that's what you do. It's like, okay, you're a production guy. You want me to help produce? Okay, yeah, I'll do a cameo. I'll direct second unit. I'll direct the scene. I got, you know, my son or my daughter or my friend, my cousin. So basically, that's how you do it, you know? So you gotta create your own opportunities. There's nothing wrong with that. Same in the music world.
Mm-hmm.
You gotta create your own opportunities, because I mean, it's rare that someone's just going to call you and say, "Hey, you know what? I just wanted to call you, and I want to put you in the movie just because." You know, that's not.
Or well, look what happened to you. You happened to be in the A in the phone book.
Yeah.
How lucky was that, right?
That was pretty lucky.
Yeah, that was pretty lucky.
Oh,
but
yeah.
That hardly—that's like
that's
one in a million.
Absolutely.
But like Jim Carrey says, one in a million. So I do got a chance.
Yeah, that's right.
Like I'm never.
That's right. So yeah, that's my thoughts and my feeling of Hollywood. A lot of good people, and it has to be some type of class that someone should create where you can navigate Hollywood. Right? You know, it's just that simple. You just have that career, have that, make sure, look, I'm gonna change the subject slightly. I believe that our men and women should have the opportunity to do two things when they turn 18.
Mm-hmm.
Go to college and not have to pay for it, or go to the military for 2 years. I think those are two options that they should have. We should create some type of options for actors that are going to educate them. And we're not going to be losing them, because I tell you, I know a lot of great actors that are gone because they weren't educated. Their parents weren't educated in Hollywood. And they went with the fan bam and the glory, and next thing you know, they're not here anymore. You know, whether it's the drugs, whether it's, you know, suicide, whether it's, I mean, you name it, it's insane.
And then what's the word I want to say? Trying to be like such and such, try to look like such and such. I know for the longest time, You know, I'm like, oh, okay, I'm too fat, I gotta lose weight, my face is too fat, my nose is too wide, or just, always something, right? Yeah. Damn fucking Twiggy.
Yeah, that's... You know?
But thank God for J-Lo, she came out and all of a sudden, big boobs, big butts and everything. You know, you can say, you know, what somebody says, hips save lives or something like that. But, you know, I've noticed some of the most famous people in the world are different, but nobody looked at that. We're talking about Michael Jackson, Prince, Donna Summer, Cher, Barbra Streisand, Elton John, Queen. All these people, were different. Mama Cass, they were different. People looked at them, their icons, they identified. I'm like, oh my God, I'm playing like Cher. Oh, look, I had a crooked nose like Barbra Streisand. And you know, right. So the more different that you are, the more valuable you can be, because people like to identify. Because you see a lot of these celebrities that look alike, and after they're in their late early 30s, you don't hear music from them anymore.
Yeah. Yeah, and you know, and I always say this, man, treat everybody like a star, because you never know who they are, who they're going to be.
Definitely.
And it's really important, you know. It's a crazy world that we live in, but, you know, I'm glad. I love this world. I love everything that goes on. I love the opportunities. I love the trials and tribulations. I really hurt, and I'm such a sensitive person, and I wish I was more thick-skinned, like my attorney keeps on saying. But it's like, they go, this is who I am. Yeah. This is how God made me. I have a heart of service. I'm a softy. I mean, don't get me wrong. You know, I can be mean if I have to. I can hold my own, is what I'm trying to say, if I have to. But anyways, you know, it's a world that's interesting, and I'm glad that I'm a part of it. And, you know, now with this whole, you know, space military, you familiar with that? What's going on? The new branch. What's it called? The new branch?
You know, you got me.
Yeah, anyway,
Space Force.
Yeah, now with the Space Force, you have to edit this. You know, with this whole new Space Force.
I gotta edit this.
I might end up going to another planet. I have a friend of mine at JPL, and we talk all the time. I go, look, when I'm 65, I'll willingly sign on a one-way trip to go to Mars to document. And that could be the end of my
life. Why does it have to be 65? That's when it's
older. Because I think my kids are going to be, you know, my grandkids will be old enough, or be old enough to hold their own. I don't have to worry anymore. And, you know, it's a one-way trip. So you figure out, I'll probably do 75, 10 years up there doing that. Why not? It's worth it. It's okay. I'm just one man. But just the whole thing that I'm going to help document, you know, in 500 years, we really might be living on a different planet. You don't know.
Well, you know, come on, for us to be as, I always tell people, you know, religions say all kinds of stuff, you know, I'm a very spiritual person, but for us to actually believe that our creator is so simple-minded to only put in this big, humongous universe, this tiny, it's a little dot called Earth, okay, that's all I'm going to do. Bye. No, there are life on other planets, and I personally think, have you ever seen Horton Hears a Who? Have you ever watched Horton Hears a Who?
No, I have not.
It's, you know, Horton Hears a Who, and then there's this little elephant that's carrying a dandelion.
Oh, it's about the book.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
Well, yeah. So he's carrying a dandelion, and the whole world of where the Who's and the Horton Hears a Who, it's all right here, right? Horton, which is, I guess, is the
elephant.
Hears a Who, and they're all on the dandelion, right? And the Who's think that they're everything. Well, shit, I think we're the Who's. And
oh man,
that's how far I
get. There's no wrong with that. You know, give me a cane, I'm with you.
Okay, but anyway, first of all, is there anything else you wanted to add? Is there something you want to tell everybody before we leave?
No, all good, man. Just everyone, you know, keep up the hard work. We're going through some interesting times. Just be a good person overall, man. Just be good. And sometimes I know it's hard. I just heard today on the radio that there's more people right now in Southern California killing each other.
What?
Yes.
Why?
Because of everything that's going on. The pressures, the no money, the no work, the COVID. I mean, literally, it was on the radio on the way up here to see you. I was like, wow. You know, it's a sad situation, man. I get it. I get angry sometimes, and I get frustrated, and I have very intrusive thoughts, like my daughter Celine says. Love you, by the way, and Larissa as well. And I do, but I think it's normal to have intrusive thoughts and to have wild, crazy thoughts, as long as we don't act upon them. Yeah. You know, we just say, okay, look, we have these thoughts, and that's it, and it's done. And I think that's part of the creativity of us as human beings, you know? So take that, use it as positive, go out there and make these beautiful candles that you're making. Look at this.
Oh,
this
yeah.
This is what I'm talking about.
And you know what? You know what? I'm hardly ever making it because they take a lot of time. This is like, let me see that candle again. This is a layered candle, and we have scent. We have one, two, three, four different types of scent. And it's a process because you have to do it a certain heat and put certain blah, blah, blah. So I actually do this, it's therapeutic for me.
Nice.
I put my energy, I put music on, I do this.
So let me tell you too, when I see this, I everything I do that I talk or I touch or I see, I have some type of association with this. A lot of stuff that I've been through in my past, movie stuff, whatever. Like, I'm gonna tell you, by looking at this, what I think. Hmm. So, like the skull here, it's like the Tim Burton, you know, Nightmare Before Christmas?
Yeah.
That hot, sexy chick? Like right there. The orange, my son's favorite color. The green was my favorite color when I was in the military. Because it was purple before I got into the military.
Oh, really?
And they go, what's your favorite color? Says purple shirt. He says green now. Okay. Yeah. And then this, the important thing about green when I was in the military is like, we did not see any race. We didn't see white, we didn't see Mexicano, Chicano, we didn't see African American, we didn't see any of that in the military. They taught us. What we seen was green, light green, dark green, green. That was it. We're all green.
Yeah.
We're all the same. So, and in the white part of it, it's like, okay, I'm guilty. I used to date Caucasian women when I was in high school. All right, you see what you created, Gilbert? I'm trying to be a comedian here.
Oh,
buddy.
My God. Well, you know what? That is my gift from me to you. You can, that's your whole life in a cup, shit.
Thank you. All right.
Your whole life in a cup. Well, again, I want to thank you for coming in and coming out of the dark, you know, whatever we're in. You know, as long as we're safe and we're cleaning our hands and putting our mask on and spraying and stuff. And you know what? Matter of fact, I actually have a sanitation spray also that Hollywood in the Park makes.
Oh,
right?
Wow.
And it comes in apple, it comes in a mint scent, it comes with fragrances. So I'm going to send you home with some of that too.
I'm excited because I know that we're going to break bread off camera. We got some great food, and I'm a foodie, you guys know it. ConcertCruiseEvents.com. Check out the cool cruises coming up. We got the Mega Cruise 2021. So we're real excited. I mean, everyone's going to be on there. Brentwood, Tierra, War, El Chicano, Pepe Marquez. I mean, just everybody. Crystal. We're excited about it. So
it's going to
be fun. So you guys go to ConcertCruiseEvents.com.
The other website,
this is October 2021.
Oh, 2021.
Yeah, 2021.
Okay.
Yeah, so get your tickets now, guys. And you guys know Captain Lou is going to be on there. We're going to have a really good time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Well, wonderful. Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
For coming. I really appreciate you coming out and risking your life, you know, with all these wolves out here and having to,
You know what? I seen there was like a lot of cougars and a lot of snakes. But I didn't talk to any of those women, I swear. I just kept on. I'm just kidding. That's Gilbert's fault. I'm just kidding. I don't judge, you know, Luke 6:37, everybody knows that. That's my favorite quote there from the Bible.
You want to give the audience any links to go to?
Yeah.
You
know, we're doing some great movies, guys. We have a couple movies coming out. Go to Amazon Prime, get Operation Repo, the movie which we released in June. Cholo Zombies releases Saturday the 24th. So you guys, this probably won't be out yet, but check that out. Cholo Zombies, the movie. We got a great movie that's going to be released February 1st, and it's called Heavy Duty Lovers. It's a love story about two heavyweight guys. It's a PG family film. Yeah, a guy and girl. Okay, so it's a love story, and the distributor decided to release it on that day, which is great. And we have another movie that's going to be released in time for Father's Day. So we got some great stuff, guys.
Okay.
Yeah. So, thank you, Techeetah. I appreciate you. And I know I'm going to appreciate that food we're about to
try. Oh, yes. Okay. All right, then. And next, we will be back with Out in the Town. Okay? Thanks, Lou.
Well, all right.
What's up, Ese? Haven't you heard? Don't judge a book by its cover, Holmes. Take two steps to the right and you say what's up. Stumble out to the left cause you feelin' drunk. Take it down to the floor with your elbows up. Move side to side as you coming up.
I think I'm gonna keep this one for myself.
We'll be seeing you soon.
This is the show where we take you a funk above the rest, where you hear the old funk, the new funk, the everything in between funk, we showcase new independent artists. And yes, we even throw in a little affection. Is this just a dream? Yep, this is the funkiest show on radio.
Ow, 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 ow. Oh. So we are gonna go to try this. We are gonna go try this place called some artisan gelato place. So now that we're out in the town. Doesn't it feel good to get out, Art?
It does. And we can't wait to tell you the exact name of the place. We'll show you the name.
Yeah, but let's go. Just for a second.
Ah, there he is.
No fingers in the nose.
The
finger
man
on the nose.
Behind the lens. The man.
And here we go.
Yeah.
It's beautiful to be alive.
That's for sure. Oh, yeah. Up it up. Up it up.
Run down that road down there.
New text message from OLG neighbor.
Really? That inter.
Exactly.
What the heck was that?
Say what?
Say what?
Did you say say what? Say what? Say what?
Hey, Lou. Oh, I'm sorry, Lou. Can't see it. It's a Starbucks, Lou. You were looking for that earlier.
Starbucks is right down the street.
Right down
the street. Oh, there. That's the ST.
Yes.
Yeah, I don't like it because you don't have a Starbucks. Yeah. Obviously, he didn't look. Okay, so we're turning in here. Oh, my God. Talking about some freaking good food. Oh, my God. This ramen boy right here. OMG to die for. Ramen boy noodle and teriyaki. Can't wait.
Never heard of it, but it sounds delicious. Oh, I can't think of eating right now.
Unbelievable.
I feel like I just finished eating.
Yeah. But what we're going
to do. Outside dining.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they do the outside dining.
Okay.
But they have some really good.
Oh, the gelato
here.
Place.
The
over
gelato
there.
Place. So we're going to go into this gelato place. We're going to put our masks on.
And here's everybody with masks on.
There's my chiropractor. Here, there's my chiropractor.
Where?
Right there in the corner. It's like, wait a minute. You can't come and get service, but you can go to the gelato place.
They're like going, hey, what's that guy with the camera for? Doesn't he have a phone?
Okay.
Oh, the gelato place. And look, hey, look, Mr. Smiles out there in front without his mask. Oh, he's got his mask on his wrist.
Okay.
That's a great place for it.
All right, so let's put the mask on.
Okay, hold on one second. We're going to go off for a minute. Is he the owner?
He said no.
Okay, well, he said no. What the hell was that about?
I don't know. I didn't even know he was the owner.
Yeah, so I asked him. I know you had to turn off the tape real quick, but I asked him if we can tape it in there, and he said no. He goes, I want to be incognito. I go, but you'll get some advertisement. And he's like, I don't have any things in there, but he got some in there. Is there there's ice cream in there?
Yeah, it is.
Why didn't he want us to buy the ice cream? Oh, you think he's racist?
Maybe. He didn't like your mask.
I don't have a fucking mask on.
Oh, I meant before when you walked out.
Shut up. Anyway, we're going to go somewhere else.
There's the racist man right there.
I'm so pissed off. I'm so pissed off. I turned your class off. I'm mad that we couldn't have fucking gelato.
I think he was racist.
No, because he let those two Mexicans in there.
Oh
maybe because we didn't have a child. I don't know.
Huh. It was odd. It was rather odd.
But the thing is, that's a place that Gigi had bought stuff from before. So if he didn't have a whole bunch of gelato.
Anyway, we're gonna go to Cold Stone.
Yeah, he.
Don't tell him we're filming. Just go in there and film.
Yeah. Not saying no darn word.
You know? Here. Tell me why. My prerogative, if I want to eat ice cream, it's my prerogative. Store.
Yeah, that's it. Well,
he just didn't want us to fail me.
I think that's exactly what it was. But, you know, I guess he had cockroaches in there or something.
Oh, maybe he was a fugitive and that was his storefront. So nobody would know where the hell he's at.
Me too. Well,
too bad.
Got him on film anyways.
Got him film. Turn right, okay?
Probably up there.
Huh?
Let's go up there and then make a right.
Are we there yet?
Yes, of course we're here. Come on.
Okay, we're there yet. Okay, just thought I'd ask at least once. Okay, here we go. Oh, we're not going to that smoke shop, are we? Oh, Cold Stone's next to it. Okay. Well, we're going to one of these three stores. Either the smoke shop, Cold Stones, or VIP Nails. It's up to you to guess which one we're going to. Oh, and here's the star of the show now.
I'm wearing my mask. Where's your mask?
I have a mask. You just can't see it because I have filming you.
Turn the camera around.
No, they're filming you.
I know, but turn the camera around so they can see your mask. Turn the camera around.
How do you do it again?
Turn the camera around. There you go.
So they can see my mask. Okay, all right. Good?
Good.
All right, here we go. Okay. So what are you gonna get from here?
I don't know yet.
It looks like they're closed.
Don't tell me they're closed. Okay.
Oh, they closed at 11.
Oh, here we go. Look at this one right here. Look at the home sprinkler. Border ahead.
Okay, I got it. You just keep on walking.
Oh, there's a problem with her.
What is she looking at?
Oh, I think I want one of those.
What is this for, by the way?
It's for the 10th episode of Hollywood in the Park. You'll see it on Roku, on Spark.
Absolutely. Yeah. We'll get your name after this, too.
Justin. My name is Justin Cronus. This is my last day here.
Why? What's the food?
Something better?
I got a better job, yeah.
Right on.
Oh, you're saying that this is not a good job?
No, you got something.
Yeah.
Okay. Why are you saying that?
We're messing with you.
I was getting ready to think you're going to the military or something.
Oh, yeah. Hooray for the red. Why didn't you go?
Yeah, I actually just joined. I'm going into the Air Force on September 18th. Or November 18th.
November 18th, okay.
Oh, congratulations. There you go.
Her husband's overseas.
Yeah.
Really?
He's in
Iraq.
He's in Iraq.
That's sick, man.
But he's been working for the military for... He did 20 years in the military, and he's been there a total of 36 years now.
36?
He got out. Consider the military like college. Whatever you learn, get out and do that. So you get paid like triple.
So I'm actually going to be
Annette's is working on that.
blue. It's just the color. It doesn't taste any different.
This is what we got today.
Yummy, yummy, and yummy. Oh my God, this is so big, it's ridiculous. Banana ice cream, strawberry ice cream, marshmallow, caramel, peanut butter finger. Yeah, those are the three.
Oh my goodness.
Oh. What are you doing?
Got a brain freeze. Oh God.
He has a brain freeze and he's filming me. There.
Well, we went around town today. We met a gentleman. He was sitting in a table outside of an establishment that we drove up to.
Yeah.
He obviously didn't want us to film or come into his store. He said, sorry, I usually don't do anything on Mondays.
Today's fucking Tuesday.
What she said. So, I took a little video of his. He still had product to sell, but he was lazy. He was just sitting there at the table.
He said, however, he wanted to be incognito.
But as we sat there, two customers came in, a gentleman with his son. They walked right in.
Latinos. So I guess we have to take the racist thing back.
Yeah.
So what I think, like I said, I think he probably, like I said, he was probably on America's Most Wanted, and his storefront is a cover. I think that's what happened.
I think we hit upon something. I think we should put plaster his picture everywhere.
I don't know about that.
So, we're going to go. We're going to eat most of this. Then we're going to throw this at his storefront window right now. Quincy, let's go. Starting to destroy that thing.
I'm going to save this for later.
You know, I don't know if I can hang out with you because, you know, you add pounds on me.
Can I put some of this cone in your thing?
No.
Tastes like pumpkin.
Thank you. Are you looking at me? Me?
Yeah, I am.
Join Techeetah Lopez and Hollywood in the Park's entire audience by advertising your brand, product, or personality with your commercial here. Email techeetah@gmail.com for more info.
Thank you.
Thank you.